In the aftermath of the First Battle of Philippi, which took place on October 3rd of the 42 BC year and ended in a draw between the forces of Marcus Antonius and those of Marcus Junius Brutus, the Caesarian and the Liberator each found himself in a position resembling that of his opponent. Although Antonius had been successful in routing the camp of the now deceased Liberator, Gaius Cassius Longinus, his fellow Caesarians, Caesar Divi Filius in conjunction with his legate, Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa, had failed to match the long formation used by Brutus, resulting in the loss of his own camp to the Liberator forces. This mistake cost the Triumvirs approximately 16,000 men. Despite his partial victory and being hailed Imperator on the battlefield, Marcus Antonius had failed to cut off the Liberator's supply lines and still faced the unpleasant reality that as the Liberators continued to employ the Fabian strategy of attempting to starve the Caesarians into submission, his own men might employ defection in an attempt to escape that fate. However, on the other side of no man's land, Marcus Junius Brutus was equally concerned over his own chances for success. It had been his partner, Gaius Cassius Longinus, who was the brilliant military strategist, not Brutus. Brutus's military career had been primarily administrative. He had been gifted his high military offices by Caesar as a favor to his mother, Servilia, who had been romantically involved with the dictator. Furthermore, because many of Cassius's legions had been brutally pressed into military service through the violent razing of their towns and the mass sale of Anatolia's citizenry into slavery for non-compliance, the loyalty of such legions to the republican cause of Brutus was questionable at best. It was several days after the first battle when Brutus finally informed his legions of the death of Cassius. In a desperate bid to keep the loyalty of the legions, Brutus paid every man 1,000 denarii, in addition to the 1,500 denarii that had already been paid to each man when the Liberator forces had first landed on the shores of Thrace. Because civil war offered little in the way of booty for soldiers, Brutus felt he needed to offer more than flat pay to keep his men. The reward he promised to those who would fight to the end and win the war, as they marched their way back to Rome, was their rights of conquest. Brutus promised them the opportunity to pillage, plunder, and rape in two Greek cities, Thessalonica and Sparta, until their bloodlust was sated and their purses were overflowing. Never mind the irony that each of these towns was formally recognized as a friend and ally of the Roman people, or that Marcus Junius Brutus was the figurehead of a movement dedicated to fighting against the unfairness of dictatorial rule. With the majority of his legions seemingly pleased by these terms, Brutus confidently pulled his forces into a defensive position surrounding his camp. There, he planned to continue the Fabian strategy of starving the Caesarian armies into submission. However, by pulling his men back and away from the camp which had been occupied by Cassius, Brutus unwittingly weakened the extra fortifications Cassius had built up to defend his camp from the men placed in the marshes by Antonius. As if given a gift from the gods, Marcus Antonius did not waste the opportunity. While sending out his forces with the intention to distract the liberators and entice them away from their hill, Antonius also sent four legions into the marshes to continue the fortifications he had begun constructing before the First Battle of Philippi. Now that Brutus had simplified his task by consolidating his liberator army at the sole remaining camp, Antonius continued his original strategy. By building through the marshes, Antonius's men could emerge on the other side and take control of the Via Ignatia, the road which connected the port town of Neapolis to that of Philippi. Should he succeed, Brutus's camp, heavily fortified by natural defenses, would become his prison. Hemmed in by mountains and marshes, and with his Caesarian legions waiting to confront them, Antonius could starve the liberators into submission by interrupting their incoming supplies from Neapolis. Although Brutus may not have recognized the danger in pulling his forces away from the marshes, many of his senatorial advisers and military officers did, and wisely pushed Brutus into responding in the same way that Cassius would have responded. Brutus abandoned his strategy of consolidation at camp and sent his legions back to Cassius's camp there to continue work on their defensive fortifications in an attempt to race Marcus Antonius to the Via Ignatia. But Brutus's advisers knew this was not enough. Despite their now working day and night on their own fortifications, Antonius had gotten a head start, and their belated efforts trailed his progress. Brutus's senatorial advisers began to envision the liberator forces being cut off from their supplies. Even the eastern mercenaries and allies began to defect, not relishing the thought of being trapped and starved to death. Finally, his advisers pressured Marcus Junius Brutus into offering battle. They were tired of delaying, watching with frustration day after day as Antonius gained the upper hand. On October 23rd, 20 days after the First Battle of Philippi, Brutus, whose forces were now repositioned in parallel alignment to the Via Ignatia, marched his legions out of the shadows to offer battle to Marcus Antonius. "I seem to carry on war like Pompeius Magnus, not so much commanding as commanded," said Marcus Junius Brutus, who according to Plutarch had dreamt of Caesar the night before. "You have chosen to fight. You'd have forced me to battle when I could conquer otherwise." And so, Brutus acquiesced to his handlers, forming his ranks and positioning his forces in three lines. His right flank, from which place he chose to command, was packed more tightly than was his left. Caesar Divi Filius, who had hidden in the marshes during the First Battle of Philippi, now marched his legions into formation, taking up his command position on the right and leaving the left flank to Marcus Antonius. The Caesarian forces were also placed in three lines, but unlike those of Brutus, their numbers were evenly distributed from left to right. With little room to maneuver, the cavalry and archers of both armies were useless. Upon the command to charge, the forces of the liberators and the triumvirs clashed in immediate hand-to-hand combat. With the infantry of both armies made up primarily of veterans, the fighting was bloody and savage, and both sides took heavy losses. As the fighting raged on, Brutus's right flank, which he had packed heavily, successfully pushed back the forces of Antonius as men from both sides fell. Caesar, who desperately needed to redeem himself after the loss of 16,000 men, pushed hard against Brutus's left flank and began moving them back. Once again, as with the First Battle of Philippi, the armies saw equal gains until the forces of Caesar finally breached Brutus's left. As Brutus's legions broke ranks and began to run, half of Caesar's men chased them all the way back to Brutus's camp, wherein the camp was plundered. The other half of Caesar's forces turned, assisting Marcus Antonius, who was suffering under the pressure of Brutus's strong right flank. Caesar's men attacked the liberators from behind, and Brutus's legions finally began to crumble. Realizing the battle was lost, Brutus called four legions to himself. As his cousin and brother-in-law, Cato, protected him, Brutus and his four legions cut their way out of the melee and made for the nearby mountains. Cato, the son of Marcus Porcius Cato, died protecting Brutus's retreat. Lucius Tilius Cimba, the man whose petition to recall his exiled brother signaled the assassination of Julius Caesar on the Ides of March in 44 BC, also fell dead during the Second Battle of Philippi. Marcus Livius Drusus Claudianus, the father of Livia Drusilla, committed suicide rather than be taken prisoner by the Caesarians. The son of the late Marcus Tullius Cicero, who had fought bravely at both battles of Philippi, now surrendered to Caesar Divi Filius, the man who had betrayed his father to his death. The young Caesar pardoned the young Cicero and welcomed him into the Caesarian ranks, along with most of the surviving liberator armies. For the liberators, the war was lost. In the mountains, Marcus Junius Brutus thanked his legions for not abandoning him. He then encouraged them to save themselves, either by escape or surrender. Contrary to his advice to his men, Brutus had no intention of being captured. Deciding to follow his late brother-in-law and fellow liberator, Gaius Cassius Longinus, Brutus declared, "By all means, we must fly. But with our hands, not our feet." Brutus then uttered a well-known curse from the Euripides play, Medea, saying, "O Zeus, do not forget who has caused all these woes." Subsequently, Marcus Junius Brutus, with the assistance of his friend, Strato, fell on his sword. When Brutus's body was delivered to Marcus Antonius, the victorious commander of the Caesarian legions took his most expensive purple cloak and draped it over Brutus's body as a sign of respect. Antonius did this because Brutus had spared his life on the day Julius Caesar was assassinated. Antonius then prepared the body for cremation and obtained a beautiful urn for the ashes of Brutus, which he planned to return to the mother of Brutus at Servilia. But Caesar Divi Filius wished no honour be paid to the murderers of his father, so that he might lay it at the feet of the statue of the divine Julius Caesar in Rome, the son of Rome's newest god demanded, as his spoils of war, the head of Marcus Junius Brutus.